Moim gościem jest wyjątkowy nauczyciel, który mimo ogromnego doświadczenia i popularności na całym świecie reprezentuje niespotykaną wręcz skromność i pokorę. Choć od wielu lat jako mówca i pisarz dzieli się swoim wglądem i inspiruje do świadomego życia dzięki sile obecności, odmawia nazywania siebie mistrzem, stawiając się na równi z każdym, do kogo trafiają jego słowa. Taka postawa czyni go dla mnie mistrzem w pełnym tego słowa znaczeniu. W prosty i praktyczny sposób uczy spojrzenia w głąb siebie. Colin Sisson.
Colin, thank you for accepting our invitation. It's a pleasure and honor to have you here today. It is said that you are living proof that no past experiences or trauma can prevent us from achieving success and happiness in our life. I wonder if that what happened to you was kind of grace or touch of God or blessing. What was that?
Well, I think my life has been blessed in a certain way because I've had some, I suppose, very painful experiences in my life. I was in Vietnam during the war there. I mean, I'm a pacifist now, but then I was a sort of a young man trying to prove himself, and most young men are trying to do that. So I went off to those crazy experiences. And I realized afterwards that I was actually trying to prove myself as a man, but trying to prove myself in the eyes of my father. Mm-hmm. My father had sort of was a very principled man, and he had some strong ideas of how young men should be. I mean, he softened as he got older, but many, many people sort of want their sons, they want to control their sons in a certain way. And so I spent the first part of my adult life trying to prove myself. And that was based on a low self-esteem. And I think that one of the most common beliefs that most people have, men and women, is that there's something wrong with me, or I'm not good enough. I have to prove myself. And when we come from that space, then we often fall into a second strong belief that there's something wrong with others who especially think or act differently to me or my family's values. So that becomes a very strong belief as well. And then the third common belief is that there's something wrong with life if it doesn't go how I want it to go. And those three most common beliefs is the very basis of most people's philosophy of life. So we're all the time trying to improve ourselves, trying to live up to other people's values. And that opens the door to all manner of manipulation and control games, particularly in relationships. And so most people really are striving to be better, whereas what my understanding is that every person has already arrived. They've already inside of them this magnificence that everybody has. But when we believe that the source of love, happiness and freedom is outside, then we can never truly be ourselves. We can never be home with ourselves because there's nothing of value inside. So we live outside ourselves.
While the healer is inside.
Yeah, I mean, the healer, the true healer is inside. In fact, the power, everything's inside. And so my work is about getting people to connect with the magnificence of who they are. And they suddenly realize that all these beliefs that they had were untrue.
Yes, this is what you say, that life is perfectly fine the way it is.
Yes.
You don't need to search for happiness outside. But why so many people have so many tensions inside of themselves? Why can they cannot connect so easily?
It's because they are encouraged that all love is outside. And we create these beliefs. And every belief we have, we will then manifest that belief to be true. We start to live that way. Mm-hmm. So that when a man or a woman falls in love with another person, they're convinced the source of love is in this other person. But in actual fact, the question I ask is, where do you feel that love? In this other person or inside yourself? So the center of love is here, and all the other person has done is triggered certain hormones and thoughts that stimulates this flow of energy for me to feel love. Mm-hmm. And because most people think that the love is out there, they then make this person greater than themselves. And most people lose themselves in a relationship. They lose themselves because, after all, they're not important. Everything else outside is more important.
But also people lose themselves in trying to connect with their inner self because it hurts.
That's a very good point, yes. Because there's a fourth belief. And the fourth belief that people have is that feelings are dangerous, particularly so-called negative feelings. Mm-hmm. And, of course, the number one is fear. And I believe that myself. And the more I tried to find love, the more I created fear in my life. And I like to experiment with life. So what I decided to do one day is I'm going to give up my search for love. I'm going to start tracking down all the fear inside of me and see what happens. Because what I was doing before didn't work. The more love I searched for, the more miserable I felt inside because of disappointment and all the beliefs that were running me. So when I started connecting with my fears and with through the power of presence, with meditation and breathing and simply being present with my fears, I made the greatest discovery of my life is that the fear dissolved into the nothing it was. And what was left was love. So I gave up my search for love and love found me when I found my fears and became fully present with them. And this is not common knowledge because most people have this belief that fears are dangerous, that their fears will damage them.
And they would get traumatized again.
Yeah, too late. The trauma is already there. That's why they're fearful. Mm-hmm. So the very opposite happens when they go in and are present with their fears. The trauma is released. And we do a special process of how to connect with the feelings and connect with the body, and when you become present with yourself, all the trauma is released.
How to get to this state? How to go through that process? Through breathing, through meditation, or what are the other tools?
Well, the breathing and the meditation is only training us, training our consciousness to be able to be more present. Because the biggest fear that people have is not the fear of life, not the fear of other people, not the fear of demons, not the fear of tragedies out there. The biggest fear that people have is fear itself. And this is not new. I mean, Nelson Mandela said this. President Roosevelt said this. And so it's a common idea, but it's not taken on board by most people. It's regarded more as a cliche. More as something, well, that's an interesting theory, mm-hmm. but let's get on with the real world, that fear is dangerous. Fear is traumatizing. Everybody has a crisis. Everybody has at least three minor crises per day. And a crisis is when I lose my keys, I'm late for an appointment, I have a disagreement with my partner, or my dinner is late, whatever.
Or breakfast is not tasty.
Or, and of course, if I watch the news for 5 minutes, I'm going to see some politician on that box that I don't like. Now, we don't realize that when we have a judgment about what's happening in our reality, that actually starts the fear process happening. The fear is already inside of us. Mm-hmm. So the average person has three crises per day, minor crises. And we have more serious crises about three a week. And we have about 12 major crises in a lifetime. Now, if you add all those up, the average person has 82,000 crises in a lifetime if they live to the age of 75.
Big number.
82,000. And our culture does not prepare us how to deal with this very common life experience. So what people are encouraged to do is try to be positive. Take a pill that will make you feel better. Or find
Smile.
some distracting behavior. Mm-hmm. And I call that escapist addictive behavior because it actually takes us from the opposite place to ourselves. So my work is about encouraging people to go inside.
And acknowledge the crisis.
Acknowledge the crisis, breathe and be present with not the crisis itself, but what I'm feeling inside about the crisis.
And for how long we should do that? Until the crisis is gone?
No, the crisis is not outside. Mm-hmm. There is no such thing is a crisis outside. The crisis is always inside. For example, see, I see a person falling down and they're hurting themselves. So, oh my gosh, that person's hurt, right? So I've had a judgment, and that judgment is telling me that I'm in danger, right? Every judgment, that's what we have judgment for. And the judgment's not the problem. That starts the process of the crisis. And so what we do is, oh my gosh, this is terrible. And that releases hormones in my bloodstream, which creates fear. Now, if the fear isn't dealt with, we go into a mild shock. And that's how every person's wired. So if I have a disagreement with, say, my partner, and she tells me I'm stupid or says some insult, I take that on board, I internalize it, and I'm now in a crisis. And what we do, most people do to handle that, is I'll go and turn on TV, pick up a book, or go and have some alcohol, take a drug. And that suppresses the feelings inside of us, which means the fear well, the well of fear grows and grows and grows. And so people, as they get older, they have to find stronger addictions, stronger drugs, stronger distracting behavior. And the whole entertainment industry is mainly aimed at suppressing our feelings.
And make your mind run away from what really is happening inside of yourself.
That's right. And most people don't have a good relationship with their emotions. And the question I ask people is, why do we have emotions? Because they're meant to be felt. That's the whole purpose of our emotions, to feel them. And when we feel them, we release them.
So there are no bad and good emotions.
Oh, dear. You said that beautifully.
<That's> there are emotions and
Every emotion just is. Because people have this idea of good emotions and bad emotions, just what you said. But every emotion is innocent. Every emotion is there, but most people don't believe that. And so that's why they go searching for only good emotions, love, happiness, and all those sorts of things. But what do they do with the fear that's already in our bodies? It just builds up, and every time we try to escape, we take the fear with us.
Do you have any daily rituals or practices or exercises that you do like every day to keep you well connected with your inner self?
Yes, I do. And we teach this on the workshops. Is like when I first wake up in the morning, I do the special exercise of being present. I look at my thoughts, my emotions, and my body. So I sort of reconnect with these important functions because I'm not these things.
Before you open your eyes?
Well, no, when I open my eyes, oh, okay, new day. And then I just close my eyes, I do some breathing, and then I just reconnect with myself. Then I get out of bed, I do some stretches, a bit of yoga. I love yoga. I do a few minutes of that. Yeah, it's great. And then I start my day. I normally give myself a session, a full session, about an hour of what shall I call breath integration, once a week. And these things are designed to keep me grounded, to keep me in my body, to keep me in my emotions, and it sharpens my thoughts so that I can really experience more of a fullness of life. And whereas as a young man, life is so busy. You're busy going from one entertainment to the other, and it's just one busy rush. And I suppose that as one becomes more settled in oneself, I notice that my life gets better. Every passing year is better than the previous year, which shows that for me is that it's bringing me home to myself more, because the love center is in me. It's not in another person or an institution or a belief system. It's all inside each of us. And my work is showing people how to connect with that miracle that everybody has.
It's a miracle of a presence, of a present moment. Yeah. So many people think about the future. They plan, they try to manifest through different affirmations, for example.
I think it's good to think of the future in terms of planning and being organized. For example, I have to catch a train to go back to Foxworth later today. So I have to plan that trip. But most people spend probably 90% of their time either living in the past or living in the expectations of the future. Mm-hmm. And when we do that, that process actually divides us from ourselves, because we're living in either a potentiality of the future or regret of the past. And these are not reality. They're not even true. So people are living by proxy or living an illusion because they're not here and now. The only thing that's real, the only reality exists, is what is here and now and happening. Mm-hmm. Everything else is an illusion. And interesting is because people are so obsessed with their belief systems that 95% of every thought comes from that element, which shows how people are so much living outside themselves.
Mm. And they miss a lot because of that.
Absolutely.
They actually miss their whole humanity.
They do, yeah. And it's not living life to the full. I worked it out one day that I think that the average person, if we spend in a lifetime from 75 years, I think it's only 2.5 years that we actually experienced life.
Amazing.
2.5 years. The rest of the time, we're either regretting the past or dreaming about something hopefully will happen in the future.
It's really scary.
Yeah. 2.5 years is about the average person that lives their life. That is scary. And when I saw that, because that was what I was doing, it was certainly a great motivation to start coming home and living life from inside myself. It's not about being introspective. It's about times when we need to be inside and times to be outside in careers, relationships, socializing. But it depends on where we're coming from. Am I coming from my own solid center of love, joy, and freedom? Or am I coming from here, my beliefs of how I think people want me to be?
And you can practice this all the time, right?
Yes.
Even here talking to you, I can get back to my center and remind myself where my attention is right now and what's going on with me.
Yes.
I can do it, and then I can practice even now.
Absolutely. And it's so simple because there's no technique. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I don't do techniques. I don't have any philosophy. I don't have any belief systems. All it is the practice of being present. In my early development, I was very much attracted to George Gurdjieff. And he described the process of presence this way. He described it as self-remembering. And so at any moment during the day, like reaching for this glass, I can just remind myself that here I am. I'm remembering myself. So each time we can come home to ourselves, but most people don't do that because we're too busy reading in our phone and this. So we're actually missing life. And that's sad because these people will reach old age and they'll look back at their life and they will not have a lot to remember.
Is being present one of the keys to success?
Oh, it is the major key.
Number one key that opens all the doors.
It does.
Okay.
But it's not the only key. We have many other keys that we do, but it's really based on the power of presence. Presence is it's not an automatic thing that you can just say, okay, I can train myself to do this automatically, because anything that's automatic is mechanical, which means it's not real, it's artificial. So the power of presence is a daily, hourly, minute by minute process of reminding myself to remember myself, to be here now. And every time I do that, I come back to that sense of the glory of who we are. And it's so simple.
And what are the other keys?
Well, because breathing is one way to help us to remember to come back. And the breath is a very powerful tool that connects us with our feelings on a deeper level. And when we start to connect with our feelings, we realize that our feelings, particularly fear, is not our enemy. Mm-hmm. It is, in fact, our friend. If we know how to work consciously with our fears, it's as great a friend as love.
Do we need any supervisor or someone who would stay next to us while we do that practice?
Yes, I think in the early stages, we do need some very surprisingly small amount of training. And it's really training not in doing something, but more in stopping doing something. Because one of the biggest keys of success is that everybody's striving to be successful. Now, when we strive, there is a belief at the back that assumes that I'm not successful, that I must strive to be successful. So what I say to people is, what you have to do to become successful is nothing.
The less you do, the more successful you
exactly.
are.
Exactly. But in saying that, we need to be present with what I'm feeling. What's going on? What am I thinking about? What am I assuming in this moment? Am I assuming and believing that this glass is good for me or bad for me? What do I need to do to be a better person? And the fact is that we are already that better person inside if we stop looking out there and turn the eyes around and look inside. Mm. I mean, I'm not religious, but I remember the words of Christ when he said that the kingdom of heaven is within, not out, it's within. And when I read that, I realized, and as I worked with myself inside, that's absolutely true.
You've been coming to Poland for several years already.
Yes.
And I wonder if you see any progress or evolution that Polish people did throughout all these years in regards of level of happiness, for example, or inner self well-being.
Well, I see the people that I work with, incredible changes. And even physically change from one year to the next, I see that, wow, the person's looking younger, they are more vibrant. But generally, I see that Poland is falling into the same traps of America. And that is the strive for consumerism. Mm-hmm. Poland and New Zealand is very much the same, is that consumerism is all about escaping an unwanted self. And so therefore, we are living outside ourselves. Oh my gosh, my neighbors have bought a new car. Oh, it's more flashy than mine. I better go and buy one too. So this is very unhealthy competition. I see this at business levels, corporations. I do leadership trainings as well. And I see that most of the leaders, not all, but many of the leaders in the country, as well as in New Zealand and especially in America, it's all about control. And control is all about motivating by fear. Whereas what I teach is give up the idea of motivation and inspire people with love. Inspire people, build people, rather than use people for a means to an end. Mm-hmm. And so I find this is more effective because everybody has a certain dignity. Everybody is a divine being, if you like. And when leaders see this person who they really are, a new respect is there. And when you respect the people that work for you, you will treat them differently as if they're just a thing. And unfortunately, there's too much of that, that people are to be used and computers and equipment are to be loved. It's the other way around. Love people and use equipment. Mm-hmm. It's the most effective way.
Is it enough to awake yourself just once? Or you need to repeat that procedure all the time?
I mean, there's never a single awakening. We are awakening a bit of the time. I mean, people sometimes have a major awakening, but it's an ongoing process. And this is why that there's nothing automatic. It's all the time is a conscious decision to be here now. And just by that alone is enough to do that awakening.
It brings you to such a meditation state.
Yeah, it is. It's in fact breath integration and integrative presence, which is our more advanced process. It is another form of meditation. And meditation is so beautiful because it brings us home to ourself. And that's all that integrative presence does. It's, again, there's no belief system, there's no technique to it. And so when people first come into this work, they're confused because the rational mind is totally programmed for doing something. And what we're teaching is a non-doing. So initially people are quite confused. They think, well, you know, and of course they're trying to sort it out in their heads, how can I fit this into my understanding of what I already know? Mm-hmm. So the whole process is not about learning something new, it's about unlearning all the stuff that we've learned before.
Getting to your natural state,
yeah.
And reminding yourself who you really are.
Yeah. So it's an unlearning process rather than a learning.
How can we define here and now? Mm. What is it really?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, most people define the here and now as like the ideal here and now as blinding lights and angels and, you know, perfect happiness and sort of that type of thing. But I teach more about the real here and now. The real here and now is, what am I feeling when my wife has just left me? Yeah. How am I feeling about I'm having to go to the dentist and I'm really afraid of dentists, or that the company is now going into receivership and I'm going to lose my job? These are the real down-to-earth here and now experiences that we need to deal with. This is the crisis that we spoke about earlier on, because in this now, I need to be really present with myself. Okay, what am I feeling? I'm terrified. This is the real truth of a person's moment. And how do I deal with that? And that's how we teach, is how to deal with that really major crisis in a person's life by being with their feelings, breathing, and coming home to their bodies, into their emotions, into their mind, being fully present with that. And that's the way they deal with this crisis.
So don't get back to some objective here and now, and
yeah.
Don't try to get connected with something that is outside, but try to feel what is your here and now, right now,
yeah.
Right in this moment.
That's right, because every person, when they have a crisis, the first thing they do is they go looking for an outside solution. There are no outside solutions. All the solutions are inside when we know where to look and how to work with ourselves. And that's what we teach.
Colin, my here and now is that I so much appreciate that we spoke today. And I'm so, so happy. Thank you. Thank you for that. You're really a master.
Thank you, Agatha.
Thank you. And hopefully we're going to see each other soon.
I hope so, too. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Więcej na portalu One Energy. Subskrybuj nasz kanał na YouTube i dołącz do społeczności na Facebooku oraz Instagramie.